Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. And on that cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great.
The Lord's house. What a wonderful day, and what a wonderful song to start our worship.
Yes.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. Don't we praise him and bless this day? He is truly awesome. We come today to praise him and to thank him for all the blessings that he gives us daily. Psalms 118 says this, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." Let us pray. Lord, we give you praise and thanksgiving as we gather in your house today. You, Lord, are almighty, and we come humbly into your presence. Let us open our hearts and open our ears and hear the message that Pastor Shawn has for us today. Now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You may be seated, and as you're finding your place, I want to invite all the kids, come down and join Miss Morgan. We've got a time for you to lead us in worship. We'll sing while you're coming.
They're small, bearing fruit as they grow tall, spreading Jesus' love through Rogers and the world.
Okay, come here. Good morning, guys, or ladies, and my two gentlemen. How's everybody doing this morning? Good. So I got up this morning, and I had this song stuck in my head, and it goes, "This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine." Do you guys know that song? So it got me thinking, what are some of the ways that we can let our light shine for God?
Sharing.
Sharing, yes. What was it, Sharon? So it shines super bright. Sometimes like holding the door open for somebody when they're trying to walk through, or helping somebody pick something up when they drop it. What's another one?
Loving.
Loving somebody, yes. Or what do you get?
Always be kind.
Being kind. That was a good one. That was a really good one. What do you have, Miss Layla? Picking up after somebody else, yes, if somebody forgot to pick up. Those are all really great things. And typically, when we do those things, do we do them and expect something in return for them? Or we just put a smile on and do them? We just hold the door open for somebody and smile and say good morning? Or we say, here, let me help you and I'll help you pick up those things? So we don't expect anything in return when we do those little things, right? But when we do these little things, they have a huge impact sometimes. You can just make somebody's day so much better by just smiling at them and saying good morning, right? So, I think that it makes God incredibly happy when we do these things. And when we do it without expecting something in return, it's called selflessly. So when we do these things selflessly, so we're not expecting anything in return for it. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for giving us helpful light.
Thank you for giving us helpful light.
Help us know the ways we can help others. And help us do so selflessly. We love you, God. Amen.
As our children go back to the sanctuary, to the back of the sanctuary for Children's Church, I invite all of you to join me in a time of prayer. As a community of faith, we are called to hold each other in God's love and God's light. And there's a list of prayer concerns that I have from you in the community. We celebrate with Josh and Angie Tway, who were married in this sacred space yesterday. Steve Willis is a disciples minister who used to serve the Christian church in Hot Springs, and he died in a canoeing accident in Alaska. We pray for peace and healing for the family in the midst of this tragedy. Tammy Sutherland's daughters, Morgan and Mackenzie, could use our prayers. Morgan has a lesion on her brain and is seeing doctors in Joplin and St. Louis to learn more. Mackenzie will likely have to have surgery to repair tendons in her ankle. We pray for wisdom and healing power of the doctors who will care for them. For the members of this congregation who are homebound and don't have an opportunity to join us in worship on Sundays, we also pray. And in first service, Jackie Lovejoy shared that a student in Austin's class has a brain tumor and he is just two. So we will hold that child in God's love and light. We also offer our continual prayers for those whose names are on the prayer list on the back of our bulletins. We pray for the leaders of our nation and the international leaders around the globe. Let us have some time of silent prayer, and then I'll pray together. God of love and God of life, your grace and mercy overcome our every doubt. Your loving kindness embraces us, holds our hearts in the midst of trials and uncertainty. You give us hope. Holy God, I ask that in this moment, in this sacred space, you would make these characteristics of you overwhelmingly evident. When we hurt, make us feel your love. When we are uncertain, fill us with your compassion. When we are afraid, fill us with your courage. Even in the deepest waters, O God, remind us that we are safe in your arms. God, this community of your people is full of life and light. Guide us in a path that is pleasing to you, that enacts justice, loves kindness, and walks humbly with you as our model. All the prayers we share, spoken and unspoken, come from deep within our hearts. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Amen.
Actually, before we start, I just want to make sure we're all on. So, can you say something?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. What a beautiful day. Amen. Amen.
A story from the Bible long ago about Shadrach, Meshach, and old Abednego. How the wicked king commanded he be thrown into the flame because they would not bow down and deny their father's name.
Mama said the king's up high upon a balcony so tall. When he looked out, he was shocked by all the things he saw. He thought that he would find them lying dead upon the ground. Instead of three, he counted four, walking all around.
I said, Mama, wait a minute. There's one thing that I must know. If three went in and three came out, then where'd that fourth man go? And I never will forget it. Mama danced across the floor. These are the words I heard her say while shouting through the door.
She said he's still in the fire and he's walking in the flame. And he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire. Still in the fire, and he's walking in the flame. And he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire.
Now, my friend, you may be destined to face life's hottest flame, but I'm glad that I can tell you through the power of his name. Not one flame of fire will touch you. You'll come through it and you'll tell. Yesterday, today, forever, God is still alive and well.
She said he's still in the fire and he's walking in the flame. And he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire, still in the fire, and he's walking in the flame. And he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire.
When my last day has ended here on earth, and my body is lowered in the dirt, I'll have no fear, though death now has me bound, 'cause I will rise up from my grave to meet the Lamb. Father, mother, sister, brother, I will see. They'll be coming, for they've won the victory. Now at last, sweet peace we finally found. For we have risen from the grave to meet the Lamb. And I will rise up to meet him in the sky. On that homecoming morning, by and by, when the trumpet of God begins to sound, we will rise up from the grave to meet the Lamb. When the trumpet of God begins to sound, we will rise up from the grave to meet the Lamb.
And we will rise up to meet Him in the sky. On that homecoming morning, to sound, we will rise up from the grave to meet the Lamb.
Branson's got nothing on the anointing in this church. Hey, we thank God for that. We thank God for every blessing, and our praise is to God. Amen. All right, I invite you to turn in your Bible to Isaiah chapter 58. We'll read verses 1 through 12 together. And I started a sermon series 2 weeks ago called Helping the Hurting. And we began by looking at how we tend to divide up into tribes. And this is my tribe, and that's somebody else's tribe. But really, and if we're honest with ourselves, we are all a part of God's tribe, a part of creation together. And so in this series, I wanted to do some deep dives into looking at some different groups, different folks that may not be a part of our typical recognized tribe. So last week we looked at the immigrant and the refugee. Today we're looking at the struggling. And so read with me in Isaiah 58. We'll read together. It says this. God says, shout it aloud. Do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the descendants of Jacob their sins. For day after day, they seek me out. They seem eager to know my ways, as if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commands of its God. They ask me for just decisions and seem eager for God to come near them. Why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed? Yet on the day of your fasting, you do as you please and you exploit all your workers. Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife and in striking each other with wicked fists. You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. Is this the kind of fast I have chosen? Only a day for people to humble themselves? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed and for lying in sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast? A day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke. Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and He will say, "Here I am." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing finger and malicious talk, And if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never, never fail. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins and will raise up the age-old foundations. You will be called repairers of broken walls, restorer of streets with dwellings. This is God's word for God's people. Would you pray with me? Oh God, we come as your community, as your body, as the members of you seeking to work together to do your good in this world, to build your kingdom. And so, God, whisper into this space. Come down into this sanctuary and whisper quietly into our ears your messages. Open our hearts to receive the words that come and to be changed. God, make us more like you. Make us ready to do the work, to go outside of ourselves and to love others, to liberate others, to work for peace and goodness, joy and hope. God, speak through me and into every one of us here, that we could be like you. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, and all of God's people pray, and together we say, amen. Amen. I want to warn you this morning that this sermon is specifically for the really good, mature Christians. And I do mean this seriously. This is some very difficult stuff. So today's sermon is for the folks who are really, really living the life, really doing the right things, really striving with all of your heart to follow God. I mean, sure, we may make mistakes, but this is for the folks who are seeking God and praying and yearning to do good. If that's you, and if that's me, then listen to this. Isaiah says, there were these people, and these people were seeking God. They were wanting to know God's ways. They were asking God for justice. They were fasting and they were praying fervently. They were doing lots and lots of good stuff, lots of holy rituals and practices. They sound really, really great. In fact, they sound a whole like us, amen? Some of y'all are with me, I'm glad. And yet Isaiah says, he says, yet they were exploiting workers. They were fighting with each other, fighting amongst themselves. They were not tremendously concerned about the hungry, the homeless, and the destitute. These folks were being so good. Don't miss that point. They were doing almost all of the right things, trying to be good, and yet God says they were missing it. And I really believe, deep in my heart, I really, really believe that it was because they didn't know. They didn't realize the situation. They didn't recognize what they weren't doing, or that this was the work that God was calling them to. I mean, if we read this scripture, it's almost like these folks had heard about Flint, Michigan. It's almost like they were familiar with the story, like they had heard about the poor people up there, the folks who were struggling with dangerous drinking water. It's almost like they were familiar, like they had heard of the infants and the children, the young ones growing up and who might be struggling with health issues now because of the unsafe drinking water. It's almost like they might have heard about the widows and the elderly who didn't have access to clean water, who didn't have access to the basic necessities of life. It's almost like they heard about these poor, struggling, deprived folks. But it didn't concern them personally. It didn't touch their own lives, and so Well, they didn't do anything. Isaiah says they were a nation that thought they were doing what was right, a nation that thought they had not forsaken the commands of God, a nation that thought that they were God's very presence on earth. And that's really interesting to me. Liz Theo Harris is one of the leaders of the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival here in America. And Reverend Theo Harris has noted, she said, you know, there were 25 or 26 debates leading up to the 2016 presidential election. 25 or 26 debates. And she said, she went back and looked at all of them. She said, not a single one of those debates, not a single one of them focused on the issues facing poor people. Now that is our whole political system, Democrat and Republican. Not only that, but in America, in this God-blessed country, we spend almost four times as much on our military, four times as much on the potential of war, four times as much on the possibility of fighting with somebody else, four times as much as we do on education and jobs and housing and other basic human needs, four times as much. And that statistic does not matter who is in the Oval Office. My friends, we believe these good things about ourselves. We believe that we are a Christian nation. But my friends, what does it mean? What does it mean to be a Christian nation? I mean, does it mean that we force everybody to be Christians? Or does it mean that our nation lives out Christ-like values? Values like caring for the poor. Values like caring for the widow and the orphan and the downtrodden. Values like forgiveness for criminals and sinners. Values like self-sacrifice, sacrificing ourselves even for our enemies. I mean, let's get totally real with ourselves. Are we really a Christian nation? Or do we just want everybody to believe like we do? This week, I had a phone call from somebody who is homeless. And this man was living in a shelter and needing help. It happens about every week. About every week, somebody will call me needing some assistance. And in our middle-class minds, I think a lot of times we think if we just give them money, it will fix the problem. Or really, we're probably a bit wiser than that, aren't we? We're probably a bit wiser, and we think, you know, what we really need is to get them into an apartment. Get them off the street, get them on their feet, and then they'd be okay. But there's something else at work. There are systems. There are other forces and other powers at work. There are forces working against that, working against people who want to break out of homelessness, who want to get out of poverty, who want a better life for their families. For instance, let me tell you a little bit about what I mean. Low-income apartments have long, long wait lists. And let's be honest, what entrepreneur wants to build low-income housing when you could build nice vendor family apartments right here in Rogers, amen? Strike one. Not only that, but what do you have to move into an apartment? First, last, security deposit, right? That's about 2.5 to 3 months worth of rent, at least $1,500 on the low end probably. And which homeless person has that? Strike two. So say, hypothetically, a friend actually secures a job. He can begin saving for an apartment, begin working towards that, but then how will he appear presentable for that job if he has no shower? How does he get to that job if he has no car? How does he buy gas to get to work if he doesn't get paid for the first 2 weeks? How does he purchase insurance to avoid getting costly tickets? Strike 3, 4, 5, 6. Even back in the days of Isaiah, even back then when Isaiah was preaching, I think life was like this. I don't think it was much different. I think there were still these same systems that kept people down, systems that made it difficult for the ones at the bottom to break free from poverty and oppression, to break free from the struggle and the suffering. And I think that's why Isaiah doesn't just talk about giving money or giving clothes or giving food, but Isaiah also talks, about loosing those chains of injustice, about breaking the yoke of oppression, about untying the cords of burden. Isaiah's talking not just about feeding the hungry mouths today, but he's talking about these systems. He says, this is what it means to be a follower of God, to spend yourselves for these other children of God, to spend yourselves liberating people from these oppressive and these unjust systems. How many of us have actually spent ourselves? Now here's the deal. This is not about guilt. And this is not about shame. But what it is about is it's about opportunity. We don't need to feel guilty about what we have because you and I have been given it as an opportunity to bless others. We've been given it as an opportunity to fight these systems, these forces of darkness. We've been given it as an opportunity to walk alongside somebody else, to be able to be the blessing. We've been given it as an opportunity to help somebody else as they work towards freedom. You have what you have. I have what I have. Our nation has what it has, so that, as Isaiah says, so that we can rebuild ancient ruins, that torn down human value of poor folks. We have what we have so that we can raise up age-old foundations, the foundation of Jesus Christ and his work in the world. We have what we have so that we can repair broken walls and systems of power would cease to prey upon the vulnerable brothers and sisters in our world. We have what we have so that we can do the work of God. Would you pray with me? Oh God, we want to be your people. But move us out of our complacency. The problems sometimes seem too big and seem insurmountable, but help us, oh God, to be the one person, the one community who begins to stand up against the systems, who begins to fight for life, who begins to fight for freedom, the one who works for salvation of the poor. Oh God, help us to be your people, to build your kingdom here on earth. God, we know that you can do it, and we know that you are calling us. And so we give ourselves to you right now to be used. In the name of Jesus Christ, all of God's people said, amen.
If you would like to give your life to Jesus Christ, accept him as your Lord and Savior, this is the time where you can come forward and do that. You're welcome to join this community of faith that challenges systems and works for justice by confession of faith or by transfer of membership. You're also welcome to come forward and we will pray with you if there is something that you would love for us to pray for. Now please stand and sing with me hymn number 489, Pass Me Not, verses 1 and 2.
Savior, Savior.
Would you be seated? These beautiful lights of God are sometimes called Bob and Joyce Kaywood. And they are wonderful. Y'all are wonderful people, wonderful blessings from God, and we're glad to have y'all. They've come to be a part of this family and officially transfer their membership to this congregation. And you all been with us a couple years. so we're glad to have you officially. It's time. Yeah. And we're glad. We ask you to reconfirm your confession of faith. Do you still believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and do you accept him as your Lord and Savior? Amen. May God bless you all as you continue this walk of faith. We look forward to hugging your neck and to welcoming you and growing with you. You're a blessing to us. If you would like to welcome them, I encourage you to stand up and reach a hand out towards them. Say, Joyce, Bob, we love you. You are God's light and God's child. We will pray for you and walk with you as we all journey towards God. You're a part of us. We're a part of you, for we're all a part of the family of God. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Jeff's got a little gift to help you kind of get to know the congregation a little better. I'll let you shake hands afterwards. Welcome. Glad to have y'all. One of the most beautiful things about this table is that everybody comes at the same level. In fact, in Disciples Hall, our chapel across the way over there, the table's actually in the center of the congregation to where it's not even lifted up, but we all come on equal footing. No matter who we are, where we've come from, what tribe we call ourselves as hailing from, we are all one. And we are all accepted at the table of God. And so as you come to this table, I invite you to remember, to remember the body and the blood, but to also see the body of Christ in those who gather at this table with you. Let's prepare to receive Holy Communion.
Certain days, because he lives, because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds a future and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. But gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory, and I'll know he lives because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because he
As we drink this cup, may the very presence of Jesus Christ himself come into us and be a part of us. A man who is poor, who is broken, who is oppressed. May we see him as we take this cup.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful today for all that you have blessed us with. Jesus said that he came so that we may have abundant life, and it is because of his sacrifice and love for us that we do. As we prepare our hearts for this offering, let us give freely back to you, Lord, with the same love as you give to us each day. Amen.
Oh,
Reach for somebody else. Connect yourself to somebody for a blessing. I'm going to share three things real quick with you. First of all, don't forget your backpacks and bags next Sunday. Bring those. Second of all, if you want to talk back, community speak back right here at this section. And then third of all, Bob and Joyce Kaywood, I'm going to send you with Kelsey to the back door to shake hands. So receive this blessing. Go from this place, seeing the blessings of God, the goodness of God's wealth of giving in you, and go with the opportunity, the giftedness to be a blessing, the giftedness to shine light, to drive back darkness, to be a force for good in this world. Go and share and give. Loose the chains of oppression. Fight the bondage of injustice, and do the work of building God's kingdom right where you are. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all of God's people said, amen.